The open range, the vast lands to the west of a young nation, home to great Indian cultures, yet to the American settler's eye, empty and for the taking. Maps of the early 1800s chart little of this region, recording it simply as the Indian Territories. States such as Texas, Kansas, Nebraska, and the Dakotas will later emerge from there and join the Union, followed by Montana, Idaho, and Wyoming. But in 1840, this land remains largely unknown, even to the settlers that began to migrate there by the thousands. The land is cheap, and in many cases, free. A place where settlers encounter no rules, no restrictions, no fences. For some, it's the opportunity to escape the overcrowded cities of the East. For others, the dream of wealth or adventure. And by 1860, pioneers settle into most every corner of the continent. Pioneers like Granville Stewart, a frontiersman who pans for gold in California and later becomes a successful Montana cattle rancher and civil servant. Ben Miskimen, a hardy cowgirl who begins to drive cattle at the tender age of 12 and runs her own herd by age 19. Evelyn Cameron, who finds solace from the hardships of the settler's life through the lens of a mail order camera. And the son of a wealthy Eastern banker, a Harvard graduate who flees to the open range for a few brief years after his wife and mother pass away on the same day. We will later call him President Theodore Roosevelt. Roosevelt, who occasionally reads Shakespeare to passers-by on the trail, wrangles cattle for several years in the badlands of the Dakotas, keeping a detailed journal of his experiences. Roosevelt writes his friend, statesman, Henry Cabot Lodge.
Dear Cabot, I have been on the roundup for a fortnight, almost steadily. When we started, there were 60 men in the saddle who splashed across the shallow ford of the river, everyone a bold rider and everyone on a good horse. Hard work, 14 to 16 hours every day. Breakfast comes at 3, and I am pretty sleepy all the time. Theodore Roosevelt.
The country's population explodes through the 1800s. With this growth comes a need for more food, and the cattle businesses of the open range expand to keep pace. Cowboys begin moving huge numbers of livestock hundreds of miles in search of new grazing areas. And in 1866, the first major cattle trail is born. But for the cowboy, it's a tough way to make a living.
I have not had on a white shirt collar and necktie but once in 3 years. I have not taken off my clothes and slept in a bed but 3 times. And during the 3 years, I have not had a razor on my face, nor attended church, Sunday school, or divine service of any kind. David Williams.
The women of the open range live an equally difficult life. They survive by wit, endurance, and often sheer will.
There is an old and true border saying, the frontier is hard on women and cattle. As a rule, the grinding toil and hardship of a life passed in the wilderness drive the beauty and bloom from a woman's face long before her youth has left her. By the time she is a mother, she is sinewy and angular, with thin, compressed lips and furrowed, sallow brow. But she has 100 qualities that atone for the grace she lacks. Clad in a dingy gown and hideous sunbonnet, she goes bravely about her work. Theodore Roosevelt.
A few frontierswomen find unconventional methods to survive in the open range. One, British by birth, decides to teach herself photography to counter the monotony of frontier life. She purchases a mail-order 5x7 Graflex camera and earns a living by traveling hundreds of miles to photograph families and free grazers alike.
Went to the Collins ranch today to take pictures of Mrs. Collins. She had a great time getting herself in room ready. She couldn't find her gown and lost her false teeth. She thought the dog had gone off with them. Finally, she wished me to go and borrow Miss Van Horn's teeth, which I did. She had to take them out and wash them first. Evelyn Cameron.
Another pioneer woman, Ben Miskimen, is equally resourceful in her means of survival. She begins wrangling cattle at age 12 and by her own account drives a herd as well as any man by age 17. When Miskimon marries and gives birth to a son, she straps the infant to her back and continues her cattle driving lifestyle. She has little choice. Her frontier husband isn't much of a cowboy.
When I was 19 years old, I married W.A. Miskimon. I had property and cattle, too. We had a mighty hard time. My husband wasn't no cowman. I tried to teach him about cows, but he never could learn, not even feed one. I've tried for 54 years to teach him, and he has never yet learned. And he never will, as long as my name is Ben McCullough Earl Van Dorn Miskimon.
Cattle driving reaches a peak between 1880 and 1885, when free grazers and large conglomerates alike move millions of head of cattle from overgrazed Texas to the northern ranges where abundant grasslands still remain.
The roundup is swinging over from the east to the west divide. We are working pretty hard. Yesterday I was in the saddle at 2 a.m., and except for two hasty meals, did not stop working until 8:15 p.m., and was up again at 3:30. The 8-hour law does not apply to cowboys. Theodore Roosevelt.
Over the decades, the constant migration of settlers into the frontier begins to take a toll. Evelyn Cameron observes this during her travels to take photographs.
The range country that you knew so well is about gone now, and the prairie swarms with farmers who plow up the land with steam and gasoline engines. The only consolation we have is that they have not begun to plow the badlands, although someone may soon invent an effective contrivance for even this. Evelyn Cameron.
But it's something more simple than mass migration or the inventions of steam or gasoline that most rapidly erodes the open range. Barbed wire. Joseph F. Glidden invents the barbed wire fence in 1874, and within a matter of years, barbed wire accomplishes what timber fences never could. It fences in the open range. The settlers rapidly erect barbed wire to mark their property. Some ranchers use it to keep sick cattle from passing on disease to healthy stock. And land and cattle conglomerates erect miles of barbed wire fences to quickly monopolize public lands, frequently those including precious water sources. One enclosure contains 600,000 acres, an area two-thirds the size of Rhode Island.
The Red River Cattle Company leased many sections of land in Clay County and some in the east part of Archer County. This cattle company intended to fence in their land. But by so doing, a number of small ranchers and settlers would be enclosed. In other words, the Red River Cattle Company would become master over all the territory. This was 1885. Small ranchers and settlers discussed their situation. It was obvious to them that all the small fellows would be pushed out of the territory. Putting their ideas into action, a volunteer committee was formed. This committee was armed with sharp axes, and they attacked the posts and wire during the dark hours. All posts and wire were cut. It required several nights to complete the job, but it was a thorough piece of work when the committee quit. Dan J. Wilson.
To halt the fence cutting, the large outfits put watchers to look out for the fence cutters, and this led to shootings. One fellow was arrested for wire cutting and placed in the Alvarado jail. The man who had his wire cut followed the sheriff to Alvarado and shot the accused after he was placed in jail. Gaston Ferguson.
Despite the thousands of miles of barbed wire fences now strangling the open range, free grazers still made a life of it until the back-to-back blizzards of 1886 and 1887. These two tragic winters brought an abrupt end to the free grazer era. As cowboys and settlers alike die of exposure, and entire herds freeze while drifting in search of shelter and food, often stumbling upon barbed wire fences blocking their path.
It snowed steadily for 16 hours. The thermometer dropped to 46 below zero. The storm lasted 10 days without abating. It was impossible to tell just what the losses were for a long time because the cattle had drifted so badly. We did not get some of ours back for a year. Our entire losses were 66% of the herd. A business that had been fascinating to me before suddenly became tasteless. I never wanted to own again an animal that I could not feed and shelter. Granville Stewart.
By 1890, America begins a new chapter in its history. 44 of the 48 continental states have joined the Union. The country is some 10 times more densely populated than mere decades earlier, and settlers, having filled it from end to end, have effectively closed the frontier. The era of the truly open range becomes a thing of the past.
Between the barren bluffs, where the prairies stretch out in billowy plains of waving grass, girt only by the blue horizon, plains across whose endless breadth he can steer his course for days and weeks, and see neither man to speak to, nor hill to break the level. Where the glory and the burning splendor of the sunsets kindle the blue vault of heaven and the level brown earth, till they merge together in an ocean of flaming fire.